Beyond, and hello, and welcome to Podcast Beyond. My name is Max Scoville. I guess I'm hosting this show again, and I'm joined once again by Brian Altano.
Good to see you all. Beyond!
Beyond! Jada Griffin.
Hello, Beyond, everybody. I'm back. They couldn't get rid of me.
Making his Beyond debut, Akeem Lawanson.
Hello, I'm making my debut on an IGN podcast in general, and I'm happy to be here. I'm glad this is the first one.
Now, I want to point something out. We are all in the actual IGN studio.
We're all
physically hanging. Akeem, you are in your home.
No, I'm here. I'm looking directly at you, Max.
Right. You somehow have like a more professional setup.
You're right there.
Like, we're all wearing these silly little hats, these little earmuffs. But how's everyone doing?
We're good. We're good. This was a surprisingly crazy news day. Good way to kind of like, you know, jump back into doing this show again. We're excited. It's we are in the big fall gaming season. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a sec. But yeah, games are coming. Mm-hmm. Not as many as historically have happened around this time of year, but we still got some big stuff to chew on this year. So
yeah.
Max, did you not get the memo that we were all wearing black t-shirts today?
I wore a black t-shirt and I changed into this one.
Yeah.
It's to symbolize turning over a new leaf. And anyway,
fresh beginnings for Beyond.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Before we get in the weeds too much, let's cover some of the news that broke. First and foremost, obviously, God of War Ragnarok is one of the things we're most excited about just in life in general. And the word is out that the review embargo is November 3rd, which is a full week ahead of launch, which is, you know, not like any of us were expecting that to be a disappointing bad game.
Right.
But that bodes pretty well for there to be that much lead time between review and actual launch. And there's going to be a preview going up this Friday, which
That's
is going to be the final preview. And it will hopefully not spoil too much. But obviously, if you're trying to, you know, stay on media blackout, Don't read it. Don't watch it.
I support my IGN coworkers and friends. I will not be reading or watching that because I've seen enough.
Yeah, I think that's totally fair.
I'm ready for this game. I don't need to see anymore. I'm completely sold. I'm in. I've been excited for this for years now. It's almost here. That's enough.
Yeah. Now, second games in series are frequently like they're like God of War 2. It's got, you know, high potential. Same with Spider-Man 2, Marvel Spider-Man 2. Great news. It is on track for 2023, says Insomniac.
Cannot wait. Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness. I'm so excited for Spider-Man 2. It's I love God of War, and God of War is my number one Sony franchise, but like Spider-Man has become my number two beyond like all their other big franchises. And I cannot wait for Spider-Man 2. It's just going to be so good. And I'm going to say Spider-Man 2 as many times because I know the people in the comments are going to be like, she said Spider-Man 2 like 800 times in that one sentence, but I don't care because Spider-Man 2.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's okay. You're totally right. I mean, there are two Spider-Man in that game, so it makes sense that it's called Spider-Man 2. I'm super excited for it as well. I mean, Miles Morales, jumping back into that suit as Miles Morales, I honestly cannot wait. Like, we're looking at the trailer right now, and like when I first saw this, I got goosebumps. Not spider tingles, but goosebumps. I'm so psyched for this game.
I picked up Spider-Man, the PC version, to play on my Steam Deck, and Miles Morales comes to PC very soon, I believe.
November 18th.
Yeah, that's right. And so it's just really awesome to remind myself that those games are fantastic. And they have some of the best player movement probably of any video game ever made.
Yeah, I think I might have to rebuy it just for my birthday because it literally drops the day after my birthday.
I think somebody else should rebuy it for your birthday because that's how birthdays work.
Yeah. Oh, Max, you're volunteering. So nice.
I didn't say anything of the sort, but someone out there should. I think it's kind of neat because like the original God of War 2 and Spider-Man 2 are like beloved PS2 games.
Right.
And here we are, what, like 30 years later or something like that? 40 years? I don't know what time is, but you know, it's been a second. But now we're getting these sort of, you know, obviously not remakes or revisits, but it's like it's spiritual successors in a sense, which is exciting. Now, as for beloved franchises, this is a really good week for survival horror fans because we are getting news from Konami. Don't clap for them.
I'm not. No, I didn't.
They're in the doghouse.
For the record, I did not clap for Konami.
Brian but has like eight of their pachinko machines.
Yeah, I'm the guy that keeps. I live in the world's loudest apartment.
So they're putting on a Silent Hill transmission, which will hopefully end some of the radio silence around Silent Hill and tell us what the capital F word, all caps, is going on over there in Silent Hill.
Would you say they're going to cut through the fog to get us some? Or would you not say that?
That wasn't the F word I was referring to. But, But no, that's going to be hopefully good. I don't know. Maybe they're going to announce a whole new wave of pachinko machines. Who knows? But obviously, by the time this episode goes up, that news will probably be kind of out there, because that's happening on the 19th, which is tomorrow. Day after that, Capcom, not to be outdone, is going to be dropping some news about Resident Evil, Resident Evil 4 remake. They're going to do a whole showcase, which is cool. So that's good news for both of those franchises, which, you know, I don't know.
I have to feel like Capcom's like out of spite, like just was like, hey, Silent Hill announced, we got this showcase we've been sitting on, let's go ahead and just air it now,
right?
Because we just want to steal all the thunder and keep control over the survival. Well,
they're definitely like, they're, you know, they're in everyone's good graces,
right?
They're like, hey, we're remaking like one of the most beloved games in our entire franchise, whereas Silent Hill is like, we made Dead by Daylight DLC and multiple pachinko machines, you know, like they've got some splaining to do. We're going to talk more about Silent Hill later on in the show. But before we get to all that, we did get some PlayStation Plus and extra premium tier library editions. New games are coming out if you pay for the top two things in that subscription service. Bunch of Assassin's Creed, AC Odyssey, Syndicate, and 3 Remastered. So if you want to go to, Greece or London or
Philadelphia,
regular England or New England, whichever. And then there's the Chronicles trilogy, which is the 2.5D sort of platformer ones. If you like Dragon Quest, or would like to find out if you like Dragon Quest, there's Dragon Quest 11, which is the big old RPG, and it's the one that's got the like the Game of the Year edition, where it's Dragon Quest 11 colon something something of a something 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 something.
Right.
Yeah. That one, play this game. If you have the extra, play this. It's their best, one of the best Dragon Quest games they've ever made.
Dragon Quest 11, colon, JRPG subtitle.
Slimes.
If you think turn-based combat and JRPGs are stupid and you would rather make things with blocks, well, there's also Dragon Quest Builders 1 and 2. And if you'd rather smash stuff or fight a whole bunch of dudes real fast, there's Dragon Quest Fighters 1 and 2. So there's a whole bunch of Dragon Quest stuff to check out. GTA Vice City Definitive Edition is going to be on PS Plus, which is cool. Hopefully they ironed out some of the bugs that was in that at launch.
Mm-hmm. There was a weird breakdown of like some of the when that trilogy relaunched, some went to the whole thing went to all platforms, but you could get some through downloadable services through Game Pass and through PlayStation Plus at the time, I believe.
That was on PlayStation Now.
Yeah, PlayStation Now. That was a lot.
So now it's actually out there if you want to properly download it onto your device and play it the way it was meant to be played. Maybe if you prefer crime in a different country, there's also Yakuza 3, 4, and 5 remastered, which are a good time. 3 is definitely the least remastered of those. I actually kind of got stuck on that one because it is like, it feels like a PS3 game, an early one.
You're killing it with the segues between these completely disparate titles, by the way.
Thanks. I might get stuck in the middle between these two. It's kind of a limbo. Oh, speaking of which,
that was good.
Limbo and Inside, Playdead's two phenomenal games are out there, which are good, you know, good, very short, kind of spooky experiences if you want some good Halloween time gaming. And if you'd prefer to remind yourself of, I don't know, Konami franchises that need more love, there's also Castlevania Lords of Shadow. And if you would like a sort of, I don't know, survival horror, Silent Hill-esque game, there is finally The Medium. So all of those are on PlayStation Plus and Premium and Extra. So check them out if you haven't. And if you have, then, you know, nod knowingly because you've played all of those games.
Yeah, and tell your friends to play the ones you like, basically.
Jada, have you not played any of those?
I have not played Dragon Quest Builders 1 and 2.
They're really fun.
Assassin's Creed Syndicate is one of the few Assassin's Creeds I haven't played. And I haven't played The Medium. So I've got a short list this month.
I'm right there with you. I want The Medium. I missed that game when it came out last year. So that one's on my list. Also, I just want to jump back into Vice City. I actually ran around the town trying to get like a hard copy of the definitive edition of the trilogy.
Oh, wow.
Never found it at any Best Buy I frequented. I'm glad I kind of missed it with everything that, you know, all the bugs and whatnot. So hopefully, like Max said, hopefully they've been worked out and, you know, I can jump back into Vice City and do some Lance Vance dancing.
Mm-hmm. Akeem, you said running around, and I thought you were like talking about in the game, like you were running around in Vice City playing.
In real life. Like, I don't have a car, so I was literally running around. I almost ripped, you know, a couple of people out of their car to steal it and drive to Best Buy. But I realized that's an actual crime. Like, I'm not going to just wake up in a hospital in a couple of seconds.
Not on the launch days of GTA games. When a GTA game launches, it's so special that cops let you legally steal one car as long as you go to the store to buy GTA. You do have to make a purchase at the store. You cannot rob the store.
Do you have to return the car afterwards? Is it like a Blockbuster rental service?
You can return it anywhere you want, or you can bring it to a paint shop to get it changed to a different color, and then no one will ever find you.
Do you think anyone's actually tried that? Like in the middle of a police chase, just like pulled over to get their car repainted?
I don't know how fast you can paint a car.
They did it in the movie Ambulance. I watched the movie Ambulance spoilers. Recently. Yeah, you know, oh, wow. They did that there.
What did they make the ambulance look like? Like ice cream truck?
How do you repaint that?
You repaint it. They repainted it. It was
not an ice cream truck.
It was not a very good job. I'm just going to put it out there.
But the alarms are still going. It's like an emergency ice cream.
Okay. All right. Let's rein this in. I was going to do a segue there where you're talking about robbery and crimes.
That was a good setup, though.
Speaking of taking a whole bunch of money from people,
mm-hmm.
We got the price of the DualSense Edge controller.
Okay.
And it is $199.99.
Woo! Sign me up.
Or £209.99, whatever. And that's not counting the additional stick modules, which are $20. Wherever you are, which is that's steep. That's an expensive controller.
Yeah,
it really is. Yeah, and guess what, guys? I actually have one here. I bought it.
What?
No, you didn't.
This is an advance. Yeah, it's look, it looks just like it. Look, this looks exactly like 26. That.
How'd you get that?
Show me.
I got some connections over at PlayStation. So no, actually, I'm not at liberty to show the paddles. It was worth every penny. I'm just kidding. I just put tape on the regular. I can't afford that. I wish I could.
How much was the tape? Because I mean, it could be about the same. You know, if you just get the really expensive tape.
Did you just block the touchpad? You actually made it less valuable, Akeem. you made it worth less money. No, so like, okay, I really think this controller is awesome. I think that like the features that they're throwing in there are really smart. Sony's long since needed something like this. Like third parties have basically been eating everyone's lunch on PlayStation when it comes to this stuff. Xbox has the multiple editions of their high-end controller. The build quality on those things are not great. That said, I don't think that this should be that much more money. Like specifically, I'll say that like two things can be true. The build quality on Xbox sucks and needs to get better. And this shouldn't be so expensive, right? Like I would like both of these controllers to be around the same price and both of them to be really well constructed. I'm hoping this thing, you know, doesn't rot and fall apart like mm-hmm. the Xbox stuff does.
What's that perfect price point for you?
I mean, I feel like 180 with all the bells and whistles, or in this case, you know, and knobs and joysticks and paddles.
Well, the funny thing is the Xbox Elite controller, which like this is the answer to that. It's mm-hmm. like 150, 160. It's around that range. So it's a little bit more pricey than an Xbox Elite controller. It would be nice if it were around that same price.
Yeah. So Microsoft actually kind of managed to one-up Sony this morning because Sony announced this and everyone's like, okay. And before I forget, the pre-orders go up on next Tuesday, the 25th. It goes on sale January 26th. Microsoft announced that the Elite Pro, whatever, the volume 2 of mm-hmm. their controller is now eligible for the design lab. So you can go in there and have the Pro controller so cool. and make it all your favorite colors and customize it to look like an Evangelion or Crash Bandicoot or whatever you want to do. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of, I feel like, kind of stepping on this announcement a little
100%.
Bit.
100%. Yeah. I'm so
pretty
sad.
Much.
I've done two design lab controllers for my Xbox, mm-hmm. and I'm upset that I jumped the gun on my second one.
Well, like,
I'd much rather get an Elite.
To clarify, like the version you're getting for $150 doesn't really have the replaceable sticks and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So you will get to customize it there. I think that like what I do appreciate about their approach is that you can buy that stuff separately. It is cheaper and you can customize it. And I think Sony is now just getting there with their high-end controller. It's $200 and you have the option to buy additional things for it. It'd be cool if they let you sort of just like go, okay, this controller is $150, but if you want to get the extra paddles or the swappable sticks, blah 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 blah, then you have that option to scale. Like I think what Sony's trying to do right now is they're outside of like kind of coasting off of the brand loyalty and goodwill from the PS4, which they more than certainly earned back then, is they're trying to be like the Apple of gaming. They're trying to do a very high-end thing. But I think what Apple does pretty well is it lets you order your phone at multiple SKUs or you know, how many gigs you want on there, what color you want on it. You're mostly locked into making this purchase, but like with this new controller from PlayStation, like it's basically just like, it's a flat rate currently. And it's got, you know, one look to it. And so I do hope that they open things up. They make that a little bit more customizable, both like from like the financial scale and also just like color wise. Like it'd be really cool to sort of be like, I want this to look like, you know, Spider-Man colors. I want this to look like Venom, like anything I want. So,
well, I mean, Sony historically loves proprietary stuff. And I feel like proprietary stuff, it tends to be sort of like one flavor, you know, it's kind of like they're defining what the proper experience for something is. Whereas, you know, changing all the colors around, that's, it's kind of getting loosey-goosey with the style guide. And I mean, it would be cool if Sony kind of loosened up about this, but I, you know, in the same way that we, it took them forever to release official plates for their wings, blades, whatever it's called. You know, we haven't really seen that many crazy, you know, varieties of color for the PS5 itself, for the controllers. You know, there've been some alternate colors, but they kind of keep it. It feels like car colors, you know, like
very
They don't get wacky with like neon purple or anything. It's kind of like, oh, like job interview red or whatever, you know?
Yeah.
I feel like in the past we've gotten, they generally come out with this basic, whatever the standard color is for their controllers for these special edition accessories. And then what, 1 year, 2 years down the line, we start seeing all these special editions, different color paths. So like, I guess my advice for others that are waiting that don't need this type of controller right off the bat is, I guess, just wait, because chances are either enough people wait and they don't sell and they go on sale and then more people buy them because they're cheaper, or they Sony starts releasing other colors to try and capture that audience.
I think that's good advice from someone who on the way into the studio said that they were going to pre-order two of these, correct?
I am going to pre-order two of them. So. Don't get me wrong. I love this controller. I'm very bummed out by the basic white controller because I currently alternate between the red and the baby blue right now. And I love those controllers. I love the color schemes that they have. I would love to have this. I would love to be able to make my blue one into this or my red one into this.
Yeah. It's wild to me because it's like I bought the PS5 digital edition for $400.
Yep.
And this is half as much as that console is.
That is a good point.
Right?
Yeah, it is a crazy point because I have the digital as well. So I'm in the same position.
This
I'm going to be buying
this
another.
This is an expensive controller.
It is a very expensive controller. So I didn't even put two and two together that I was going to be buying another PlayStation 5 basically by pre-ordering two of these controllers.
Yeah, you could buy another PlayStation 5 digital and it would come with a controller.
Yikes. Well, let's take a minute, sort of take a look back at the other very expensive controllers that have come out over the years. Not just PlayStation ones, but I think it's kind of funny to sort of look at the, you know, the wide range of prices you get for stuff like this. Obviously, there's the Xbox Elite controller, which debuted at $150, and a lot of people were like, get out of here, that's insane, no one's going to buy that. And then it's obviously proven to be pretty successful. People are pretty big fans of it, and they've put out Series 2, which is, I guess, $180, and then it's got, I think, you know, you can, you know, chalk that up, get more expensive with it. Fight sticks, joysticks, and racing wheels, always very expensive. Like $150 is cheap for something like that.
Right.
So that's we're kind of discounting that. And obviously, if you get into like, you know, PC hardware, you know, that's out there. Back during the PS4 era, the sort of only option for this that was like officially licensed was the SCUF Vantage controller.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is the first one that had like the, you know, adjustable triggers and adaptive dome caps and back buttons and levers or whatever going on there. And that was $200 at launch. Yep. And I think it kind of had like a mixed reaction.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Jada, did you ever mess with one of these?
I've used a SCUF controller. I never invested in one myself, just because I've always preferred the feel of the first party controllers.
Yeah.
But I loved, you know, I'm glad that Sony followed suit on the PS4 when they released the back paddle attachment, like super late in the lifespan.
Oh yeah, that's right.
It was super late. But you know, and I was hoping that PS5 was going to have that at the jump.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm glad they're at least putting it into this controller, because I love being able to move my buttons around and being able to disable certain commands by moving them to the back buttons and not using them in certain games.
Mm-hmm.
Now, an infamous controller was the Mega Jockey 9000, which is the official title for that Steel Battalion Xbox controller.
I've used that.
That thing is such a cool piece of hardware. There's a video of me like playing with one without it plugged into anything, but
I had one traded into the GameStop I worked at one time. It was a pain in the butt to test
because it's got like 200 buttons on it.
Yeah.
I had a friend back when I lived in New York City that had one of those and then also had like the world's tiniest apartment. And it was like, you're putting all your skill points in a Steel Battalion here. I respect the escapism.
That's hardcore. No, that was a beautiful thing. There's the insane
how much bit was that of
engineering.
Thing?
That was $200 at launch in 2002, which adjusted for inflation is around $329, which is a pretty steep price.
But it came with the game, right?
It kicked ass. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. I like that there was a Steel Battalion sequel that was a Kinect exclusive, which is the opposite, where there's just no controller. and then, of course, there is, I was kind of looking back, weirdly, it's kind of hard to find the MSRPs for various peripherals, but the Nintendo Power Glove, one of the earliest stupid ways of playing games, was $75 in 1989, which is about $180 adjusted, which,
yeah.
You know,
yeah. If you knew someone with that, they were a rich kid or their parents were going through some troubles,
mm-hmm. like Lucas.
You know, well, they were breaking up.
It's pretty expensive now if you're actually trying to get one in good condition. I've tried numerous times on eBay. It's just that I'm not willing to pay like $300 to $400 for it.
The Power Glove?
Yeah.
I got one. I got one in Austin at a used game store a couple years ago, and we were shooting Fast Travel, and I wore it to one of those like axe throwing places. Which I don't know if that feels like Mad Libs, but I'm not sure if any other people can say that.
Wait, were you holding an axe while wearing the Power Glove? Is that what you were saying?
Damn right I was.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. Look at that. It was a terrible controller, Akeem. You might as well throw an axe with it.
Now, one thing about the Power Glove, if you look really closely, you'll notice that it's so bad.
Yeah.
I mean, it's got a lot of buttons. Which is
what's
nice.
So bad about it? What do you mean?
No, I'm quoting the wizard, man.
Not bad meaning bad, but bad meaning good.
It's so bad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Akeem, you know you had a pinch to punch people like that. You didn't actually do a lot of motion stuff with that. To like hit people and punch out, you had to do like little pinches with your fingertips. It was not great.
I saw like how kids in the hall play punch out.
I guess I'm not looking at it because I want to use it practically. I just mm-hmm. like the aesthetic of it, and so I kind of just want it like as a display. So I want it in like good condition. But I guess actually using that to game, it does, I don't know, it looks kind of weird.
Akeem, do you need it to go in a trophy case next to your Infinity Gauntlet?
Pretty much. No, I need it to go next to all my other Nintendo trophy stuff that I have over here, my PlayStation lamps and whatnot. I just need it to kind of, just for my decor.
To tie the room together.
It's definitely the coolest looking overpriced peripheral. Yeah. But I'm curious what our audience makes of the DualSense Edge. Moving on, obviously Konami is teasing the future of Silent Hill. They're going to have the Silent Hill transmission and hopefully tell us what is going on over there in Silent Hill and why it's been so quiet. It has actually been very quiet in Silent Hill. It has been, as of last Sunday, 1 decade since the last Silent Hill game, which was Book of Memories, the Vita exclusive, which came out October 16th, 2012, which was, of course, the dungeon crawler take on the beloved survival horror game, which
best way to play Silent Hill, you know, it's the best version.
People were so on this. I don't think it was, you know, particularly reviled, but it definitely wasn't what people kind of signed up for. Did any of you play this?
No, I did not. If I knew this existed, I forgot, but like it's been long enough that I'm really interested in checking this out now. Actually,
I did play it for a short while because I bought my Vita at launch when I was working at GameStop, and so I got to try a few games because somebody bought it and traded it in immediately because they hated it. Not a surprise there. But I could not get any of my other friends to play it with me, so it was not a great experience solo for me. And I wasn't the hugest Silent Hill fan back then. So back in the heyday, I wasn't the biggest fan. So yeah, that kind of, you know, says what it is for that game. Mm-hmm. It just was kind of eh.
Yeah, I was gonna ask you if you remembered any of the characters, like, because like the thing I think like one of the problems with Silent Hill is the fact that like when you establish like a new franchise, what you need to do is you need to go in there like with like a strong ensemble. And one of the, like, you know, like if you look at Resident Evil, you know, the first mm-hmm. couple of games, we have Chris Redfield, we have Jill Valentine, we have Leon S. Kennedy, and they've come back in other games. What Silent Hill did with, like, we had Harry Mason, we had Sybil. Harry died in 3, while his daughter Heather went to see him, and he was just dead. So then she's like, "Why is my dad's dead?" And he was like, "He was one of the main characters." And then the main character of Silent Hill 2, he died in 2. He was like, "I want to see my wife." So then he killed himself. So it's like what they did was they kept killing off the main characters. And I feel like, so they never really established like, okay, this is our core cast. for Silent Hill.
Right.
So each and every game following were just a new cast of characters. They had some that came back. There was like a truck driver named Travis in Silent Hill Origins. He was also in, I believe it was Downpour. He dropped the guy, or he dropped someone off in another game. He never spoke. He
dropped someone off was, another game.
Yeah. He was like, hey, here's this city. Here's Silent Hill, man. You know, have fun. It's all foggy. And then he just drove off.
I like that your fog machine went off the second you said that.
I love that you are adding fog to this discussion about Silent Hill, which is awesome. I mean, because Konami has, 2012 was not a great year for Silent Hill. Book of Memories was kind of, I think, maybe the highlight. That was the same year they put out the HD remaster where they took out a bunch of the fog.
Yeah.
They were like, people hated the fog. They couldn't stand it.
They couldn't see
too
through
much
it.
Fog. Yeah.
I loved the fog. One of my lights just went out. I think I'm actually entering into Silent Hill right now.
you summoned something.
Like, the thing with me is, like, I really love the franchise. And so it just kind of, like, Harry Mason was such a strong character. I was upset when he died in Silent Hill 3. Like, right. he was a writer. He went to save his daughter. He didn't know how to use a gun. He didn't know how to use melee weapons. That's what made it, like, he wasn't like he didn't know how to use a gun. And so that's what made it more challenging.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that, you know, he died. But then the thing with Silent Hill is they have, like 3 to 4 different endings. And they always had that UFO ending, which was like a gag. So, you know,
and
he came back with the dog.
Is, yeah.
Yeah, the one with the dog. Yeah, with controlling machines. It was weird. It was a weird franchise. But what they failed to do is, like Resident Evil, is have those established characters to carry on the franchise. So I don't know. I feel like that's part of the reason why we never saw anything for like the last decade now.
Yeah,
you know?
And you know, to like you actually make a really good point about the legacy of Resident Evil. And I think another thing to add to that is sort of just the practicality of actually playing those games. Resident Evil has been ported to pretty much every system ever made. It's been remade, rehashed, refreshed, rebooted in so many different directions. It gets new installments. There's remakes of the legacy versions. You can buy the old versions of the games. Like, Silent Hill is basically kind of locked to a lot of the consoles that originally launched on, outside of the HD collection, which, like as Max alluded to before, was kind of reviled because they took the fog out. And I think a lot at the time of 3D gaming, during like the N64 era and PlayStation era, people sort of conflated fog with the lack of sort of the technical prowess of the systems being able to render long distance backgrounds, right? But for Silent Hill, that worked in its favor in terms of moodiness. And whoever decided to port the Silent Hill games for the remakes or remake them for the HD collection was basically like, well, fog is bad because it means you can't see stuff, so we'll take it out. And it's like, it just robbed all of the... It's like taking the fog out of like the poster on The Exorcist, right? It's like it's missing the entire point. And so not only can you not play a lot of these games legally on modern consoles, but the HD collections, which you can, are kind of crappy.
Yeah.
And so like it's such a bummer for fans. And so there is no legacy of those characters. There is no legacy of being able to play those games. And we've really had to work with recently is like a couple of like rumors and leaks from Bloober Team, who worked on the Medium we talked about for a second before. And then this news that we're finally getting some more stuff on Silent Hill. So yeah,
right.
Not been great for fans.
Obviously the elephant in the room is PT.
Yeah.
Which is could have been so cool. I want to point something out because people
Is there an elephant in that room? I always saw the ghost.
It's actually the good ending. It's like the dog. The elephant is just pulling a bunch of strings behind the scenes with its trunk. You gotta shove peanuts through a hole in the wall to get him. No.
PT Barnum.
People there it is. People give Konami a lot of shit for being just a money grubbing greedy company, but if they
why
were
would they
really
do that?
If they were really proper, okay, so they're definitely greedy
despite everything.
You're not giving them credit for how vindictive they are as well,
mm-hmm.
because I think it says a lot of how much that breakup with Kojima was nasty. That PT is a game that just last week we heard about people jailbreaking their PS5 so that they could, you know, sideload the PT demo,
yeah.
which is unavailable to download. It was up for less than a year. It got released at, you know, Gamescom. It was the playable teaser for what would have been Silent Hills. We all know this. People are straight up like voiding their warranty. They are breaking the rules of owning a PS5 to figure out a way to play this game.
Wow.
Konami could just sell it.
Yeah.
Like people are going out of their way to consume a piece of marketing materials. And they're like, no, you can't have it. It is easier and more legal to buy a used PS4 that has this installed on it than it is to just get it running on a PS5. Mm-hmm. And it's nuts to me that, like, you know, Konami hasn't just poked their head up and been like, we could charge $5 for it and probably make a lot of money off of something that's just sitting
and get
there.
Some goodwill. Yeah,
they could sell it for $20-$30 and people would buy it. Like, I'm not giving them ideas. I don't want them to. Let's not give that company that idea.
I don't want to suggest that's a thing, but I think it is fascinating that this is something that people are clearly so hungry for.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's not even a matter of like, oh, like they could remaster Metal Gear and put it out. That requires a little bit of work. I think they literally just have to flip a switch. Like there was a story going around a little while ago about the person whose job it was to delist that and how bad they felt about doing it. That's on the PS4 store. It's out there. Like people own it. They have it on their you know devices.
I deleted mine. I cannot re-download it because it just does not.
I have it saved on a hard drive still.
Yeah. Like, see, I mean you're smarter than I am.
It's just wild to think about. But instead, what we've gotten, you know, since Book of Memories and the Silent Hill HD remake and PT is a bunch of just kind of really weird use of the Silent Hill license. There has been not one, not two, but three pachinko machines based around Silent Hill.
All of which that are in Brian's apartment.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Which is why if you try to call him on the phone there, you can't hear anything. It's just balls rattling. Yep. Just a constant clanging.
It sounds like machine guns
down
there.
It's a din. There's Silent Hill, the Apache slot, which is released in 2015, which is based on Silent Hill 2. Mm-hmm. I don't know how a pachinko machine has a plot. They obviously have like little cutscenes that play, and when it's in between the balls dropping and it yelling at you, and you know, I don't know, cigarette smoke shooting out of it or whatever. And then there's Silent Hill Escape and Silent Hill Return, which are respectively based on Downpour and Silent Hill 3. And
these have all come out since the last proper installment, which came to Vita.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Why would you? And my only question is, why would you make a pachinko machine based on Silent Hill Downpour? I don't know if you all
because
know
there's
the plot
a downpour of balls coming from it, the pachinko.
Oh my god!
Pachinkos are like the least silent thing.
I think the most ironic.
Yeah.
Thing out there, it's very funny. Anyway,
a bummer. What a bad time.
Yeah. I mean, the premise for Downpour is a guy, he purposely goes to jail to kill a guy, and then he gets transferred, and then the he gets transferred to a different prison, then that something happens to that bus, and then he escapes, and now he's in Silent Hill.
Man, that sounds like a real gamble. Not unlike gambling. So the other thing aside from pachinko machines is we've gotten DLC for Silent Hill characters in not only Dead by Daylight, where you could play as Pyramid, the Executioner, Head, and Cheryl Mason, and there was a Midwich Elementary map. There's also a game called Monsters and Mortals, Dark Deception, which got DLC. And it's really fascinating to me because these are both like kind of those asymmetrical horror party type games, which seem to be kind of like one of the more successful, more profitable ways that people are, you know, making horror games these days. But they're also like, they're not really conventionally scary. They're not like scary in isolation the way classic survival horror is.
Right.
And it's funny because like, to see Konami kind of pivot this franchise and be like, well, we can't figure out how to do, you know, the single player route. And maybe they've announced, you know, a single player route since we're having this conversation. But it's funny that they're like, yeah, let's just license out Pyramid Head.
Right.
Whereas Resident Evil is like, well, let's sort of segue into action and then we'll randomly make stuff like, you know, Resident Evil like Reverse or Mercenaries.
Resistance.
And to do what Akeem did before, like to recenter this as a Resident Evil fan, imagine if we didn't get Resident Evil 7, 8, 2 remake, 3 remake, or the upcoming 4 remake, but Chris Redfield still came to PUBG. Like, that's what it's like being a Silent Hill fan. It sucks. Yeah,
pretty much. Very weird.
And one of the things that they could have done, so with the video game Silent Hill Shattered Memories, it was kind of like, you ever played like Spider-Man Shattered Dimensions? It was kind of like that, kind of like a multiversal thing. So it was a retelling of Silent Hill 1.
Right.
So different ending. So they could technically rework it where, you know, like the main character, Harry Mason, has like a different outcome and he doesn't die in Silent Hill 3. I don't know. I'm just spitballing. I just want more Silent Hill. Mm-hmm. And I wish they didn't kill off the main character who was like the mascot, mascot in quotes.
Well, yeah, Akeem, I honestly would be amazed if the next decade of Silent Hill is somehow worse than the last. Because it really,
we'll check back.
Let's find out.
let's see how that ages.
Yeah. I've made worse predictions. Anyway, moving on. we want to try some new stuff on the show. We want to kind of get a little bit silly without getting too silly. You know, can't get too silly, but we want to have fun. But we can't have too much fun. But we want to have a little bit of fun. One way we want to have fun is by introducing some games. And we thought of a stupid idea for a game. I thought of this. So if you're mad at it, it's my fault. And I'm sorry. One thing that sets video games apart from all other mediums is the amount of times that they make you hear the same annoying sound effects countless times over. So here's a new game that we're calling What Was That Noise? And it's a game where we play one of those sound effects out of context, and then we have our panelists try to guess what it is. Did you hear it enough times that it's burned in your memory? Let's find out. All right.
Okay, I'm ready for this. Are you all ready for this?
I'm not ready at all.
All right.
You're not ready at all?
I'm not ready at all.
We're gonna play the sound effect. Let it sink in. Let our audience play at home. Don't just shout it out. But let's, Red, can you cue it up?
Ooh.
I got it.
I think I have a guess for this one.
Akeem?
I have a guess. it's probably not right, but I have a guess.
Okay.
Let's hear it one more time.
Yeah. It's wet, but also wood. Right? Like, it doesn't.
It's got
like
a lot of motion to it.
Yeah, it's like a soggy 2x4 hitting.
Yep,
a
that's
lake.
Right. That's the sound of the boat from Skull and Bones. You heard it. Let's play it again. That's the boat. That's the wet wood boat.
I don't think there's any iconic sounds from Skull and Bones.
No, not yet.
Except for the clock ticking as it gets continually delayed.
All right.
What?
I mean, it's true. He
Come
can't,
on.
He can't.
All right. Do you want to hazard a guess?
Yes. I think it's Spider-Man shooting a web, doing a thwip.
Jada?
I'm going to say it is a screw attack from Samus.
Oh,
this is a PlayStation show. What's
I
wrong
know,
with you?
But it, that's what it sounds like.
I'm wearing a Metroid
Akeem, do you have the answer?
Yeah, it's the sound when you click start in Gex.
You know what? We have such a beloved Gex members in our community that just want Gex to come back. Every stream when there's like games that are going to be announced, like, where's Gex? Where's our next Gex?
People want Gex. Now we have one more sound, a follow-up sound. These sounds are kind of their companion sounds. Let's hear the second one. Can we hear them back to back?
Oh man, so that second one is less of a like a thwip. I'm still going with it. Maybe does Spider-Man do that with his?
He does do thwips, but it doesn't sound that mechanical.
Yeah,
Brian, I'm thinking it's like from like some RPG, some I don't know. It just has like a very, it just sounds like an Elden Ring type sound. I don't know if it's from Elden Ring.
Ooh, is that it's not Bloodborne, is it?
You give up?
Yeah. Yes, I think any last guesses,
Jada?
I have no idea. I was like
the portal gun. It's the
it is the portal gun.
I thought that was going to be way too easy. I thought that was going to be like a dead giveaway. So that one of those was the sound of turquoise, and one was the sound of orange.
I have not played Portal in probably a decade.
I've only played that game on mute.
What?
I don't think I've ever played it with sound.
Like, that's the best part of the game is the sound. Like the audio dialogue.
How am I? I didn't know that. I was reading subtitles.
There was that song at the end that went viral.
I remember reading the lyrics. Yeah.
This is a triumph.
All right. So I thought that maybe that was too easy. I don't know what. Audience, let us know what you think.
You have to hear those sounds like 1,000 times in that game.
Yeah.
And I did not put that together.
Yep. That's just the portal sounds.
I think Spider-Man also makes that sound, though.
I'm still going to say it was definitely very similar to the screw attack from Samus.
I appreciate how stubborn we are that we're just doubling down on our wrong answers in the face of facts and information.
All right.
Good work, Max. You successfully stumped us all
so maybe that
on
was
your
too
first
hard.
Round
I,
of what
I thought
that sound.
Was. All right. So I don't want suggestions for this. I mean, maybe if you have suggestions, write into beyond@ign.com if you've got some good sound effects you want to share. Maybe you want to just send us a WAV file and have us all guess and try to figure out what it is. And I don't know how we're going to find out the answer. I guess you just write angry comments in the video, whatever. So that was What Was That Noise. Now, moving on, there's been a lot of talk about remakes and remasters and what makes a good one and why you should do it or not. And Brian, you have some strong feelings on the matter.
Yes. I just wanted to hijack the show for a minute and say something that's very near and dear to my heart. And I think many of you will agree. Let's see. Hot off the heels of the remake of The Last of Us, a 9-year-old game that had already gotten a remaster, and the recent rumors that the next modern classic PlayStation game to get the remake slash remaster treatment could be Horizon Zero Dawn, a 5-year-old PS4 game. It seems that Sony's going to keep finding new ways to sell not very old games to new audiences, whether we all like it or not, and whether we keep rebuying them or not. So given that, here's my plea. There is an incredible and beloved modern classic PlayStation exclusive game that actually could benefit significantly from getting a fresh coat of paint and a technical makeover, and it's called Bloodborne. Give it up for Bloodborne.
Oh, clapping.
Legally have to say Bloodborne on this show. Bloodborne first dropped in 2015. It was 1080p with a sort of stable 30 frames per second. That's being generous. It had forced chromatic aberration, which gave everything that weird kind of jiggly look, and had some very rough load times. The load times improved significantly with a few patches from FromSoft, but they never really went back to tune up much else. Despite all of this, Bloodborne is a masterpiece action RPG horror game with some of the best art direction, world design, boss fights in all of gaming. And yet, it's kind of hard on the eyes these days, especially if you're used to stuff like 4K 60 frames per second, HDR ray tracing, and dynamic foveated skeletons. Or whatever. I made that last part up. FromSoft, now, they've never been like the most technically exceptional studio, but that's okay, because Bluepoint, the team that made the gorgeous Demon's Souls remake on PS5, are more than capable of modernizing Bloodborne. Pair that with the fact that FromSoft's Elden Ring, a equally tough, beautiful action RPG, is one of the most popular and critically acclaimed games of the year, and it's safe to say that a PS5 remake of Bloodborne would be very well received. So Sony, if you're gonna remake modern games, remake Bloodborne. I don't ask for much, but I think I speak on behalf of all of us when I say that a hunter should hunt beasts, and they should hunt them at the highest resolution and frame rate available on the PlayStation 5, and a year or so later, the personal computer. Thank you.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Preach.
Give it up for Bloodborne.
I was a little shaky at the start. You nailed the landing. I don't have a card to give you a score.
Why would you admit to not wanting Bloodborne?
I didn't say I didn't want it. I said it was shaky on his opinion on it.
Oh, right.
It started out a little shaky, but he nailed the landing.
You know what? Fair. But, just like Bloodborne, you start off, it's tough. You get your butt kicked, but then by the end,
exactly.
You're killing people.
See, Brian gets getting
Brian, you're down. So brave coming out here and saying such a controversial thing.
I know.
I know a lot of people out there are trying to stop Bloodborne from getting remastered. They're putting up a big fight. They can't stand the idea of it. They say it's too scary. There's too many noises in the game. They don't like it.
They're like, I want an unstable 20, maybe sometimes 15 FPS when I'm fighting a boss or running through the open world.
There's actually people out there trying to make it have a lower resolution and a worse frame rate. They're straight out there demaking Bloodborne. Mm-hmm.
They are, and it looks gorgeous. They're also making a kart racer.
Yeah, it is actually warped that we're going to get a PS1 version of Bloodborne before we get a PS5 version.
That hurts. I mean, people have reverse engineered the PS4 version to run on PC. Obviously, like, it's easy for me to say, like, without, I'm not a game designer, right? For me to just come out and be like, make me this thing and make it better. I'm a spoiled king in a diaper. But like, the reality is what they're trying to do here is they're trying to take a game and modernize it on PC. They're porting it themselves. Fans are taking over this. But there's like that game is built around, you know, the hit detection, frame skips, and all that fun stuff is all happening because of the PS4 hardware. But it's just, it hasn't ever really gotten that like big, beautiful bump that the next gen consoles should be able to give it. And I just hope that happens someday.
I'm pretty sure the spoiled king in a diaper is a Dark Souls 3 boss.
That's right. Kick my ass.
Yeah. Anyway, we have one last thing to talk about here, which is, I think, pretty funny. We frequently talk about how, I don't know, video games, they need some legitimacy. It's sort of, it's hard to take them seriously, but what are they going to break into the world of fashion? I don't know, they did like a Final Fantasy 13 Louis Vuitton line or something. Now, Horizon Forbidden West is teaming up with ASOS to make official Horizon Forbidden vests. I'm sorry.
Damn it.
No vests, though.
There's like a sleeveless, there's like a large t-shirt. They've got these, you know, it's a line of clothes. These are, you know, kind of a step up from your typical, like, you know, you see on the PlayStation store of like, oh, it's a hoodie or it's a shirt. They've got like an all over print. I don't want to call it like a Hawaiian shirt, but it's like a, you know, it's a button up that's got the robot dinosaurs all over it. And it totally reminds me of those Guy Fieri Dragon Ball Z shirts from the early 2000s.
Oh, right. Yeah.
it's kind of cool. I'm into it.
I think I could pull that off.
I mean, to be quite honest with you, as someone who prides themselves on their fashion, I mean, it's kind of mid, like, looking at some of these things. It's not it's not really that impressive. I don't see too many people buying into it. I mean, like, again, I'm a fan of Horizon Forbidden West.
And you love clothes.
Well, yeah, absolutely. And I love wearing clothes. Not just loving it, but I love wearing clothes. Looking at this, the aesthetic doesn't really scream, you know, like the world of, you know, it doesn't scream the Horizon Forbidden West world. I was thinking that they were going to have like maybe Silence get up. Like, I want to dress like, you know, right. Lance Riddick, you know, they have, it's just prints on joggers and hoodies. And it's just,
you wanted something more in universe, basically.
That's what I was expecting.
That's kind of that's sort of my go-to when you hear, I mean, I don't typically buy a lot of video game clothes, but I always did sort of appreciate, like, I don't know, like Metal Gear has been good about that. I'm like having like, here's like a vaguely tactical bomber jacket that looks like Big Boss's get up or whatever. Right. But this is so distinctly not in universe. Like, this is very much like, the models even look like, where the F are we? They're like wearing sweatpants and stuff. But.
So I'm always kind of like on the fence when it comes to gaming branded clothing. I like my stuff to be very minimalistic to wear, or minimalist to wear. If you know the fandom, you know what that shirt is. You know that what that is portraying. Right. I don't need giant logos saying Horizon. I don't need to have things.
You have a big shirt on that says Eat, Sleep,
right.
Hunt,
Repeat.
Eat, Sleep, Hunt, Repeat, but it does not say the game.
No, like, it doesn't.
If you don't know what that is in reference to,
then that's Monster Hunter, right?
It is Monster
Hunter.
That's
Cabela's big game hunter, right?
That is also correct, yes, because you hunt and you repeat that constantly and you eat while you play. And then you sleep.
Yeah. Now there's some. We got some pants up here, which is a weird sentence to say on this PlayStation show. But these are like a little more. These
Pants
are a little
Station
more
plus.
A little more Aloy-ish. I don't know.
Those are Max. Those are the ASOS X Horizon Forbidden West unisex co-ord joggers.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Thanks for,
not again.
Thanks for
not
clarifying.
Really screaming the game. Do they come with boots? Like, they look like they have fishing boots at the bottom of them.
No, that's just the
pants sleeve.
Okay. Are they zip offs? Yes. Are they like
they're two tones? No, okay. they're just two tones essentially. And
you ever
again,
game
like
so
it's...
much that your legs get hot, and you got to turn your pants into shorts. Because I do. I need more zip off gaming jeans. I do.
But I got to say, this is great for anyone that is that such a huge fan that you feel like you need to wear a hoodie that has Horizon Forbidden West on it while you're playing the game. Mm-hmm. So
there's one shirt on there that's actually kind of rad, which is like a sort of comic style like panel of Aloy, which I'm into.
But I saw that. Yeah.
Yeah. It reminds me of like if they had an instruction manual like in the olden days.
I want to give a shout out to Insert Coin. They make a lot of stuff that's like based on PlayStation IPs that is kind of more minimalist and occasionally in universe. Like I wouldn't wear it, but they made like the RPD, you know, Raccoon Police Department like jacket that makes you look like you're a cop in that game.
I am actually waiting on an order to show up from Insert
there
Coin that has it's Ghost of Tsushima. It's got like the little foxes or whatnot. They're like pajama pants, and they're super cute, and they're like it's perfect. It's like it's totally Ghost of Tsushima. It's the perfect foxes for it. And I also ordered the Final Fantasy 14 paladin jacket because that's just what I play in Final Fantasy 14. And I was like, I want to show off my pride. Nice.
Uniqlo just did some Final Fantasy stuff recently too, right?
I have almost all of those shirts.
Cool. So you have options if you're a nerd.
You know, this seems like a trivial thing to discuss. And quite frankly, it is. It's absolute hogwash. But I think it's kind of cool to see, like, I don't know. It used to be if you wanted like a gaming thing, it was like a t-shirt with just a big graphic smattered all over it. And now it's like, well, there's still a lot of t-shirts with graphics on them, but it's like, this is, you know, clearly a little more attention has been paid to this, and it's, I don't know, it's nice to see.
Let me just say this though. I got to put this out there. Shout out to ASOS for this collaboration, because hopefully this opens up more collaborations with other video games. I know I said it's mid, but still, I think there is an audience out there that's probably gonna purchase this. It's just not for me personally. But I hope this opens up more doors for more collabs with PlayStation and just other video game companies in general.
Also, like they didn't. Again, this is not none of this is remotely sponsored, but I do want to give a shout out to ASOS because they have pants for tall people. I have like a 36 inch inseam, which is basically just like a rare drop. So if you need long pants because you got big legs, go check them out.
And remember, collabs sometimes are like pancakes. You got to throw the first one out and wait for the second batch.
That's true.
And so maybe the next collaboration will be a lot better.
No, Jada, you eat all your pancakes.
I
still eat them too, but like the second one is always the better.
That's a Ralph Lauren quote, isn't it? He said that famously. Anyway, I think it's about time we wrap things up, but thank you all for hanging out with me. Akeem, thanks for joining us for the first time ever on a IGN podcast, and we're looking forward to having you back.
Thank you.
You've got some strong feelings about some things that our audience might have some strong feelings about.
100%. I have too many strong feelings, and I can't wait to share them with you all. And if you feel the same way that I do about Silent Hill, let me know in the comment section down below. Oh my goodness, this isn't even a fog machine anymore. This
what is
just,
that?
You're just vaping, dude.
Yeah.
No, yeah. I have Shaggy down there token up right now.
Good lord.
Akeem, where can people find you regularly?
You can find me on the Entertainment Fix right here on IGN. You're talking about all the entertainment stuff. I want to shout out to you, Max, and Brian and Jada for allowing me here on Podcast Beyond. I mean, I listened to this podcast for years, and with all of its different iterations, so it's actually pretty cool and kind of surreal that I'm actually here on the podcast. And I don't think I've earned the right to say Beyond yet, but I will
say it.
I'll let the audience decide. If you all like me, if you want to see more of this guy talking without a script in front of his face, mm-hmm. let us know in the comment section down below.
Can I say you will tip them in your favor if you yell Beyond? That gets you in their good graces.
Really?
Yeah.
Try it. Mm-hmm. Yep. They hate me because I never do it.
I say it all. I say it too much. So split the difference.
You've got the PlayStation passion. Let it.
Here we go.
Okay. Here we go, everybody.
What the hell is he doing?
Beyond.
Good lord.
Oh, that was great. That was really good.
Yeah, that's going in history books.
All right. Yeah,
that's what happens. Was that good?
I guess that's the Beyond when you inhale the smoke machine for too long.
If you step on his neck, he just shouts that. Shuts off. Anyway, we got to wrap things up. Thank you all for joining me. Thank you for everybody listening and watching at home. I'm stoked to be back. I'm also terrified and nervous, so thanks for bearing with me through any ums and uhs and stutters. I promise there'll be lots more ums and uhs in the future because sometimes I don't know what to say. But hopefully we'll have lots more stuff to say next week. We'll see you back there next time, same place, and beyond.
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 There it is.
IGN Playlist is all of your games in one place. You can build your library and discover new games. Create and follow playlists from friends. Access guides for what you're playing. And rate and rank the games you love to share with the world. Available free with your IGN account. It's for players, no matter where you play.